مرحبا بكم كلكم في جلسة بتاعت أسترازينيكا سيمبوزيوم. جلسة هي عبارة عن ديبيت في السي او بي دي. هيبقى عندنا very interesting two lectures or two speakers وفي الديبيت واثنين highly recognized وappreciated الأستاذ الدكتور مجدي إدريس والأستاذ الدكتور عادل خطاب. الديبيت هتبقى عبارة عن to use ICS in COPD Pro. دكتور عادل خطاب هنبتدي بيه، وبعدين الكون اللي هي الكونتراديكتوري اللي هو دكتور مجدي to use IC in COPD اللي هي الكون في الديبيت. وهنشوف الأول، هنعمل بس ناخد رأيكم في الفوتنج الأول، وبعد كده بعد ما يقدموا التو توكس بتاعتهم هنشوف رايكم اتغير ولا اتغيرش، هل انتوا برو ولا كون الاي سي اس ان سي او بي دي. نقدم كده اول حاجه في اول سلايد عشان ناخد رايكم بس فيها. الفوتنج باد اخدتوها ولا ما في الفوتنج باد اتوزعت؟ السؤال، do you use of ICS in COPD, do you usually use ICS with LABA in COPD, yes, no or not sure. فرأيكم ايه فيها عشان نعرف رأي السادة فيها. يا تامر انا ما عنديش فوتنج باد بالنسبه لي. فالماجوريتي 57% من الاتنديز قالوا يس، نو 28%، واللي ماسكين عصايه من النص وسط حزب الوسط 14%. فبس هنفتكر، اكتب الحاجات دي يا تامر. يبقى البرو 57% يعني يس، لو 28%، not sure 14%. اوكي. السؤال الثاني، you usually introduce ICS in COPD management، هل بنستعملها early late ولا برضه number 3 not sure؟ فالأرلي 40%، هنقول 41% أرلي، وبرضه حوالي 55% ليت، ونوت شور حوالي 5%، نوت شور. أوكي، هنبتدي بالأستاذ الدكتور عادل خطاب الأول في الديبيت. وزي ما قلنا الدكتور عادل خطاب هيتكلم على to use ICS in COPD، he's a pro ICS in COPD.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ثانك يو دكتور طارق، بشكر حضراتكم جميعا. طبعا بعد الماراثون احنا قاعدين 4:15 والغدا يمكن خلص 5 وي، لان احنا متواجدين هنا. انا شخصيا تعبان قوي، ولولا الكوميتمنت يعني ولولا ان انا ابقى مع حضراتكم كل واحد، فعلا الماراثون كان طويل جدا. طبعا زي ما قال الاستاذ دكتور طارق انه انا ومجدي، مش مجدي زي ما بحب ان انا ان دايما يتقال له، احنا اصدقاء جدا ومفيش اي خلاف، والاختلاف في الراي لا يفسد للود قضيه. وانا طبعا بقت مهمتي سهله، لان من البدايه ده في 55% بيوز الاي سي اس، لكن يعني انا هحاول ان المقاعد بتاعه الفرد تبقى اكتر، تبقى 80% عشان يعني ناخد السيطره. اول حاجه عشان احاول اللي مش مع استخدام الاي سي اس هقول له، اول حاجه انه الديفينيشن بتاع السي او بي دي في الجولد، كل الديفينيشن لغايه اخر ديفينيشن بلا 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 بلا، وبعدين COPD is associated with an abnormal inflammatory response of the lungs. هو inflammation. ده أول حاجة. ده الباثوجينيسيس لما الايرويز تتعرض لايذر سيجر سموك أو الإيرتنس، المسألة بتبدأ بالستيميليشن بالالفيولار ميكروفيجز مع الإبيثيريال سيلز، وبيبقى فيه بقى الكاسكيد بتاع الانفلاماتوري سيلز، النيوتروفيلز، السي دي اي وكل الميدياتورز. كل ده this also is an inflammatory process. ده من ناحية الباثوجينيس. هل الانهيلد كورتيكوستيرويدز بقى في الاكشن ليها رول؟ ليها، لانها بتنهبت السيتوكاين سينثيسز انكلودينج الانترلوكين 8 ليكوتراين بي 4 والتيومر نكروزس فاكتور الفا. Also, it inhibits macrophage activation when secretory leukotriase inhibitor would decrease L-mucus secretion. That can meta-analysis study, اللي هو meta-analysis study pooled من 7 randomized trial comparing the ICU بالبلاسيبو والendpoint كانت المورتاليتي. النتيجة بتاع meta-analysis ده 7 study ICS associated with 27% low risk of mortality. مش كده وبس، حتى في العيانين اللي هم على اوكشن ثيرابي ICS associated with 45% lower risk of mortality. لما ناخد الاستاديز اللي بتقول انه positive effect of ICS في الـ COPD against the studies اللي بتقول there is no effect، اظن واضح الكفة مايلة فين. الاهم من هذا وذاك، دايما بنقول ايه، السيف اصدق انباء من الكتب. باثولوجي الستادي دي بقى كانت باثولوجي، ومين اللي عملها؟ دكتور مجدي. اللي عملها دكتور مجدي بيتر بارنز، وما ادراك من هو بيتر بارنز. الستادي دي كانت بتشوف الانتي انفلاماتوري افكت اوف كومباينيشن اوف سالميترول فلوتيكازون كومبيرنج النمبر اوف انفلاماتوري سيلز في البرونكيال بايوبسي والانديوسد سبيوتم في البيشنت اوف سي او بي دي على مده 13 اسبوع. بيشوفوا السي دي 4 سي دي 45 ماست سيلز، كل التيومر نكروزس فاكتور، انترفيرون جاما، التوتال سيل، كل ده. طبعا ده مع ان هما كانوا بيشوفوا الاكسسربيشن والفانكشن، لكن انا هتكلم من ناحيه السيلز. النهايه، النتائج، انترفيرون جاما، سي دي 45، ماس سيلز، سي دي 4، تيومر نيكروز فاكتور الفا، سي دي 68، سي دي 8، كله في امبروفمنت الكومبينيشن اي سي اس لابا اف كومبيرد بالبلاسيبو. في تو ستاديز على اليوز اوف كومباينيشن بيودرسينويد فورميترول في التريتمنت اوف سي او بي دي، ودول كانوا الستادي، دول الستادي كل ستادي بتقعد 12 شهر سنه، زفرنسكي والكالفيرني. النتائج، الكومباينيشن ريديوز ذا ريت اوف اكسازربيشن ريكوايرينج ميديكال انترفينشن. الكومباينيشن اف كومبيرد بيودرسينويد لوحده، الفورميترول لوحده، بوث ذا ستادي هنا في significant reduction أو significant reduction للإكسازربيشن، واضح جدا مع الكومباينيشن. وبرضه الكومباينيشن أدى إلى reduction للنمبر of oral steroid courses in both studies if compared باللابا لوحده أو الاي سي اس لوحده. Improvements in FEV1 improvements marked في الكومباينيشن عن اليوز اوف اي سي اس اور لابا لوحدها. السان جورج ريسبيريتوري كويستشنير التوتال اند امباكت سكور ار سترونج بريدكتورز فور مورتاليتي ان 1 يير في السيفير سي او بي دي ستادي، وكان ناحيه اليوز اوف كومباينيشن اوف اي سي اس مع اللابا. اولسو الكومباينيشن increase the number of nights without awakening. The combination if compared with ICS alone or LABA عمل ايه؟ أدى إلى reduction في الـ use of beta 2 agonist reliever medication. طيب هل ده مع this combination only؟ لا. التورش ستادي اللي هي كانت السالمترول فلوتيكازون، التورش ستادي استخدمت الكومباينيشن فيرسس بلاسيبو عشان تشوف all cause mortality هنا over 3 years in patient with moderate to severe COPD. ده كان البرايمري اند بوينت. السكندري اند بوينت كانوا بيشوفوا الافكت اوف ذيس كومبينيشن في المودريت والسيفير اكسسربيشن فريكونسي وبرضه الكواليتي اوف لايف. نتائج البرايمري اناليسيس اول كوز مورتاليتي ات 3 ييرز كومبيرنج سالميترول بروتيكازون كومبينيشن مع البلاسيبو 17.5% ريسك reduction و 2.6% absolute reduction. The rate of exacerbation requiring systemic corticosteroid over 3 years, the combination if compared with placebo, 43% reduction, who can significantly exacerbation أقل من السالميترول لوحده أو الفلوتيكازون لوحده. بالنسبة لل improvement of quality of life the same. The combination أحسن من اللابا لوحدها أو الـ ICS وطبعا أحسن من البلاسيبو. Another study اللي هي الـ SUN study ودي كانت 12 months randomized double blind multi-center study حوالي 2000 عيان 40 سنة وأكثر عندهم moderate to very severe COPD. هنا خدوا 4 arms. أول arm combination of budesonide formoterol بس 320 مرتين في اليوم. الأرم الثاني نفس الكومبينيشن بس 160 مرتين في اليوم. الأرم الثالث لابا فورميترول 9 مرتين 9 مايك والأرم الرابع بلاسيبو. الكومبينيشن ثيرابي either two combination either two concentration significantly improve lung function وA as early as day 1 والimprovement ده كمل لغاية ال 12 آخر ال 12 شهر. ال speed study دي combination أو study عملت comparison ما بين ال two combination ال budesonide فورميترول versus السالميترول فلوتيكازون. دي انا مش هعرض نتائجها لكن هي نفس النتائج. الادفيرس افكت في اليوز اوف كومبينيشن مع الكنترول ات از ذا سيم. السيريس ادفيرس افكت ما زادتش. ده كان الايفيدنس اللي احنا بنقول وي هاف تو يوز اي سي اس مع اللابا. طبعا ما فيش خلاف على ان احنا نستعمله في سيفير والفيري سيفير، لكن كتير من الاستاديز اللي حضراتكم شفتوها كانوا الاستاديز دي هي على المودريت سي او بي دي. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
شكرا دكتور عادل. And we proceed بالقن. حقيقة تو سبيكرز very powerful. عادل خطاب ومجدي ادريس.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, assalamu alaikum. Well, I think Dr. Khattab is well known to everybody. Scientifically, he is super, basically Superman. And convincing, he's really good. He really almost convinced me, almost, because he really showed very nice data and made my life actually very difficult to try now to convince you that the other way of the equation is probably more important. What I'll be doing over the coming 10 minutes, I'll start with this statement that inflammation in COPD is steroid resistant. Not only that, it's even resistant to oral steroid. Not even inhaled steroid does not work in COPD. Oral steroid does not work in COPD, except if you talk about acute exacerbation. I'm talking about on the chronic basis. Data has shown that only 10% of patients, if you give them trial of oral steroid, will get better. And those who gets better, they have mostly eosinophilic infiltration, i.e. asthma COPD. So it's really clear to really start with that not even inhaled steroid, but even oral steroid does not work in the COPD. Now the second problem here is what COPD we're talking about. Now COPD is not a homogeneous process. We know that there is emphysema, there is chronic bronchitis, and there is a mixture of these two. So it's very difficult when you look at the clinical studies to know what kind of COPD we are talking with. Are we talking about purely emphysema, purely COPD, mixture, early, late, etc. But I'm going to tackle this issue from two angles. I'm going to show you why I believe that inhaled steroid is ineffective in COPD, and two, data that it could be even harmful in COPD. Let's start by the first one. If you look at the flow of literature over the last 20 years about the use of inhaled steroid in COPD, you'll find that in the early 90s, there was 5 randomized clinical trials that was released in that time. And at that time, it showed clearly by those initial 5 trials that steroid does not modify the natural history of the disease. It did not slow down the loss of lung function. Few years later, there was another set of literature, randomized controlled trial, and tried to look at different angle. They also confirmed that inhaled steroid does not modify the disease progression, but there was some hint that it might decrease the exacerbation rate and improve the quality of life. Well and good. Mid-2000s, again, there was a set of clinical trial trying to talk about the combination of 2 drugs, inhaled steroid, LABA, as combined. And let me remind you about something here, that inhaled steroid, LABA, is not simply inhaled steroid. It's totally different molecule. The end result is different than using inhaled steroid alone and LABA alone, because these 2 drugs, they have synergistic effect. It's like just saying that Lasix work very well in heart failure, especially if I add captopril. And I'll say, okay, so captopril adding changed the equation here. So it was this kind of combination of inhaled steroid and LABA, which again showed data about the physical exacerbation, quality of life, and there was a hint, especially in the TORCH study, and then basically ISIC study on the mortality issue. And then, as we heard from Professor Khattab regarding the inflammatory data. Now, let me rephrase things. I think we all know what steroid do in asthma and do in COPD. Now, steroid manipulate inflammation to clinically relevant state in acute asthma or in chronic asthma. You do see the effect, lung function improve, biopsy improve, patients improve. This is not clinically relevant whatsoever in COPD. There is no clinically relevant modification of inflammation in the COPD. Plus, COPD manipulate mostly the non-important mediator in COPD. Not all important mediator in the COPD. And recent data show that actually inhaled steroid might prolong the life of a neutrophil because it opposes the apoptosis mechanism and make neutrophil lives longer, so the effect in the lungs might be worse on the long run. And this data tried to look at this, looking at what does inhaled steroid do in 2 important inflammatory processes in COPD. Number one, the effect of histone deacetylase basically system, which is very necessary pathway to inhibit the inflammatory gene. And as you can see here, when you look at the use of dexamethasone on very high dose, there was no improvement. The HDAC pathway was suppressed and the steroid did not improve that at all. And even when you look at the interleukin 8, which is extremely important mediator, unlike interleukin 3 and 5 that are inhibited efficiently by steroid, and they are more important in bronchial asthma, on interleukin 8, inhaled steroid did very little on inhibition of that. So I believe that this inflammatory effect, it is very minimal and it is not clinically relevant. So what about the clinical output, the exacerbation, mortality, etc.? And when people look at the data and they try to test the methodology of these studies, there was major problem in these studies' methodology point of view. And let me go through with you. If you look at what happened when those patients were randomized, most of those patients, not all of them, most of them, they were in a they were on inhaled steroid initially. But when they were randomized, they went into run-in period where inhaled steroid was stopped for 2-3 weeks, and then the patient were randomized into steroid versus no steroid. And when people look at these kind of what so-called benefit of inhaled steroid, it was entirely on those patients who were prior user of the inhaled steroid, not on the steroid naive patient. What does that mean? That means that if I am not using a steroid for a long time, and I am COPD, or you gave me inhaled steroid, the effect on exacerbation and mortality is almost zero. It's only if I use steroid for a long, long, long time, then you ask me to stop the drug for 2-3 weeks. Of course, I feel worse because now I'm steroid depleted. And then you gave me steroid again, I start feeling better again. So you can assume that the effect is because of steroid. It is because of steroid depletion and restarting, as shown clearly when you reanalyze these data. It was not on steroid naive. All the benefit came on those who were on steroid stopped and then restart them on those treatment. When you look as well on the intention to treat process, those of you, the scientists who does clinical trial, randomized clinical trial, and go for intention to treat, it's extremely important not to violate that, to have a valid result of your studies. So what happened on those data, that most of those studies that did not respect intention to treat, yes, showed some benefit. However, when you look at the data from the studies who were properly conducted, there was no mortality advantage and almost no exacerbation advantage. What I mean by that, if you have one study for 2 years of study, for example, and I as a patient drop off after 2 months, I use the drug, then for some reason I stop using the drug. The real way methodology says that you should analyze me at the end of the study. You cannot analyze me at the 2 months, because at 2 months I was probably okay. I did not die. I was okay. So you are analyzing me as a survival. But I might die 6 months later, and then if the study is 2 years, it should be 2 years analysis. So in the ISIC study that Professor Khattab showed us, 27 improvement data, they did not respect intention to treat. While when the TORCH study respect that, and they did 3 years analysis, there was, as a matter of fact, little increase in mortality. It was not significant, but there was increase in mortality in the fluticasone group. So that's definitely different than 27% survival advantage. And what I'm trying to tell you here is that it is analyzing the methodology of the studies are very, very important. Now, finally, again, I'm telling you, it is the combination business make the data contaminated. Because now if you look at, for example, from the TORCH effect, the so-called survival advantage came mostly from basically solmeterol. It did not come at all from the inhaled steroid. That survival advantage of 17% came almost, when we do post-hoc analysis, came from solmeterol, not from inhaled steroid. So it is again, this message is coming that inhaled steroid probably is not doing much, and if it does anything, it is not clinically relevant in those patients. So if you look at the interim conclusion here, COPD is really heterogeneous disease. It's not like other disease that it is basically simple one entity. Inhaled steroid is not effective in COPD, and I can show, and I think it's clear that even oral steroid, you can try oral steroid in your patients, and you will find out that most of them, they have no benefit, but they have side effects. The anti-inflammatory response is not clinically relevant. Previous studies have major methodological problem when they analyzed. Finally, one word about, is the drug harmful? in those patients. Now remember that most of those patients are really elderly, they have a lot of comorbid illnesses. And now the data is showing clearly that inhaled steroids, especially the longer one of the high dose, increase the glaucoma, cataract, osteoporosis get worse, and we know that COPD itself causes osteoporosis, so now you are giving drugs that make osteoporosis even worse, adrenal efficiency, but the problem, which I think we need to draw attention to, is the pneumonia. And if you look at different recent study analyzing this in particular, showed that in any combination of inhaled steroids, either alone or with long-acting DHO agonists, pneumonias was almost increased by 50%, 45%. So almost doubling the risk of pneumonia by giving the inhaled steroid for a long, long time. And that's been shown even as a mild or as a severe, basically, attack. So it is like this. We are looking for a drug that it is not very effective, clinically having very non-relevant anti-inflammatory effect. The studies who showed effect have some methodological problem. Most of the well-designed study failed to show that effect, and the drug could be harmful as well. So to me, I don't have problem in really say that steroid is not the proper anti-inflammatory drug that should be used in the COPD. It's definitely the drug of choice in bronchial asthma. In COPD, it is far from the anti-inflammatory drug that we want to treat COPD, and we should look for other anti-inflammatory drugs that does the job far better than steroid. And again, I will end from where I start. COPD inflammation with steroid resistance and ICS does not work in COPD. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you, Mahdi, for your elegant presentation. So it's time for the second. We'll see the statistics. We'll see the audience, the floor. ايه رايكم هيبقى يس نو نوت شور ولا هتبقى نفس الريزلت هي يس كان 57% نزلت ل 42% 43% نو 57% still not sure 0%. Congratulations, Emak. Then taktasaht. يعني the voting system كان 28% بقى 57%. دكتور عادل hard luck 57% بقى 43%. Not sure كان 14% بقى 0%. طب أي أسئلة بقى الدكتور مجدي عشان نعمل توازن شوية؟ جمال اتفضل يعني نقدر ناخد 2 or 3 comments لعادل ومجدي عشان نشوف نحاول نوازن الفوتنج سيستم اتفضل يا راجل برضه short question و short answers
الدكتور مجدي والدكتور عادل شكرا جزيلا على الاثنين توكس بس كنت عايز اسال الدكتور مجدي احنا بالنسبه لاخر سكول كورس كانت عمل في ARS وكان بيتكلم على المونيتورنج بتاع الايروي انفلاميشن وكان الكونكلوجن بتاعه انه ان نعتمد على السبوتم سايتومتري في المونيتورنج بتاع الايروي انفلاميشن وجد ان 40% من حالات سي او بي دي في ايزينوفيليك انفلاميشن واب تو 30% من الازماتيك بيشنت عندهم نيتروفيليك انفلاميشن وده اعتقد هيغير الكونسيبت هل نعتمد بقى على سبايرومتري عشان اشخص السي او بي دي والازمه ولا اعتمد على السبوتم سايتومتري عشان اشوف مين اللي ريسبوند للاسترويدز ومين اللي دونت ريسبوند.
Well, thank you very much for the point. And again, the point here showed what I was saying that it's sometimes difficult to really isolate COPD from chronic difficult to control asthma because you do have mixture. And it's clear in the literature that there is those 10-15% that they do respond to even all steroids significantly, lung function improved significantly. And there is those asthmatic who have, either they smoke or they have brittle asthma, and those they have neutrophilic way of really inflammation. So you do see mixture of the two. So what Dr. Khattab and I were saying is not saying that it is clear, white, and black. It's those patients do exist. And really, we all see patients get significantly better with inhaled steroid. They are so-called COPDers. And we saw those patients who did not do any better at all. The lung function, the symptoms, the exacerbation did not change. And I think because what you are saying, sometimes you don't see that clear basic cut between the two groups. You have patients who are COPDers, but they are also atopic asthmatic. And you have asthmatic who really smoke, and they tend to be COPDers. So you do see this combination. It is not a homogeneous disease, correct.
على البرزنتيشن شيقة جدا لكن الحقيقة ليا كومنت بختلف مع الأستاذ الدكتور مجدي ولو إن إحنا أصحاب قوي لكن ده في الرأي العلمي الحقيقة اللي حضرتك اتكلمت عنه في الـ COPD كأبسوليوت كده ما ينفعش لأن إحنا دلوقتي بنتكلم على فينوتايبس أوف COPD we have a lot of phenotypes of COPD and what have been modified in the last gold guidelines السنة دي and you should individual treatment according to the phenotype of the patient. But we have, and there is an evidence that inhaled steroids in severe and very severe COPD is evidence A. By evidence A, we mean that it's based on a randomized study, which is on... مش محتاجة أول. حاجة تانية, the oral steroids, are evidence in exacerbation and they are indicated. الحقيقة إذا احنا اتكلمنا على إن الآي سي إس مش هتأثر على progression of the disease, طب ما اللبن مش هتأثر على decline in the function. ودلوقتي في question mark كبير على ال FEV1 اللي احنا معتمد عليها when it's not the mirror of what is going on in COPD. We have some bronchitic patients, we have some emphysematous patients, we have patients with asthma component. ما نقدرش بقى نعمم الموضوع كده. كومنت صغير قوي عن النمونيا. النمونيا البرزنتيشن يو هاف از 2007 اللي قالت ان النمونيا انسيدنس ان دوز سي او بي دي بيشنتس كانت اعلى ورجعوها للاي سي اس يوز. But it doesn't affect the mortality and it's there in any سي او بي دي بيشنت. وبرضه نرجع تاني للفينوتايبس. There's some phenotype of COPD in which there is high colonization and some have low colonization of bacteria. فما نقدرش فيعني انا ما بختلفش لكن بعرض الرأي العلمي اللي مبني على evidence based medicine A. فما اقدرش احط الستيتمنت الأخيرة اللي حضرتك حطيتها it's steroid resistant. It's not a treatment for etiologic treatment, it's a symptom relief. ما عندناش symptom, ما عندناش أي treatment هتقلل الـ progression of COPD, هيفضل في طريقه ماشي لغاية النهاية يعني, لكن it's different from one patient to another.
صحيح. I'll try to answer, because these are very valid points. It almost kills my lecture. So now, I think if now there's voting after the comment, it can be different. But let me try to comment on these things. I do totally agree that there is different phenotypes between the patients. Definitely. Not all COPD are the same. But that's true in any disease. That's true in asthma. That's true in the pulmonary hypertension. That's true in most diseases. There's different phenotypes, and now this is becoming very hot topics in COPD, that different phenotypes of COPD. But we are talking about in general terms that would inhale the steroid in the classical COPD environment. Change anything if you use the inhaled steroid. Now, the randomized trial that looks at evidence A, and those are actually, there was actually meta-analysis looking at it. These are, if you look at people criticizing it, there was some criticism about the methodology that I did mention. Actually, none of those meta-analysis took that in consideration, that intention to treat. And when people reanalyze the post-hoc analysis, they find, well, maybe the outcome is a bit different. It was really exaggerated when we did talk about that one. However, I have to accept what Professor Adel and yourself are saying. Some patients get better. We do have patients get better. I'm not saying, please don't take it that I'm saying, I do use inhaled steroids in COPD, of course. I do combination of LABA and COPD like anybody else, but I'm saying we need to be careful when we say that the data is showing that inhaled steroids work in COPD. I'm saying the data is very challengeable. It could be really part of it is really correct. Part of it is really methodology problem that when the statistician look at the data, they said, well, we disagreed. There was some problem in these studies. But I cannot say that what you are saying is not acceptable. Now, regarding the pneumonia issue, yes, there was no increased mortality, except recent meta-analysis in 2010 reviewed that, and they found that the one-year mortality was less in those stages. So, yes, the 30-day mortality was the same, but the one-year mortality was less in those patients. So again, this is a signal, a small signal, but it is there to say maybe COPD are not doing always good. And we have to be careful and we have to really individualize the treatment. So your point is well taken.
For the sake of time, just two questions, small questions with small answers, please. To say we talk.
هو ديمقراطيا لازم اكون مع مجد لكن يعني برضو السلفيين لان كونها تنزل من 57 ل 42 وتطلع من 41 ل 57 مساله يعني يمكن انا مع عادل أنا متأسف بقول عادل ومجدي لأنهم إخواتي يعني في تو زونز واحدة الجراي زون اللي بيبقى فيها سي أو بي دي فيها أسماتيك إيلمنت بتقول حوالي 12% من الحالات عند هول هارتدلي يبقى الكورتيكويدز لها مكان والثانية الفيري سيفير فورمز وهو ده ستريس عادل في الآخر لكن برضه مع احترامي لمجدي برضه دوجماتيزم ان نقول ستيرويد ريزيستنت انا معاك في انه نيوتروفيليك الانفلاميشن وان الكومبليكيشن نمونيا نوت اونلي اكيوت اكسسربيشنز اوف سي بي دي نمونيا ار ماتش مور لكن برضه ذير از ستيل بليس في التو زونز اللي انا قلت عليهم مع عادل ثانك يو
انا موافق تماما على ان ال الدوغماتيزم is not in favor of scientific debates لكن والجراي زون اللي قال عليها استاذ سيد بيه موجوده طبعا وديت استيرويد ويل ورك ان لكن انا شايف ان الابيوز اوف استيرويد هو ده اللي لازم نستريس عليه مش اليوز اوف استيرويد هون انديكيتد بتكلم على الابيوز اوف استيرويد ان دي تبقى روتين لا this should not be سواء كان ال هنوافق على الان افكتيف وكويري هارمفول او مش هنوافق عليها لكن اللي مش هنوافق عليه ديفينتلي باي اول دوجماتيزم ان يبقى في ابيوز اوف ستيرويدز ان سي او بي دي واخدين ان ذا باك اوف ذا مايند ان اي عيان بيزيق اي عيان بينهج اي عيان بيجي لنا احنا ها يبقى ياخد ستيرويدز لازم الراشونال ده يطلع من دماغ الناس واللي عايز يعمل سبيوتم او يعمل بال ويشوف اذا كان في ايزينوفيلز ويتش ديزيرف ان يبقى في ستيرويد اديشن يعمل لكن ما ننساش برضو ان الاستيرويدز ليها يوفوريا والاستيرويد كان اكت از بلاسيبو افكت وكل الاستادز اللي اتعملت في البلاسيبو في الـ في الـ في الراندمايز كنترول دبل بلايند كروس اوفر ستادز هتلاقي حضرتك ان البلاسيبو لوحده بيعمل افكت الاستيرويدز تعمل افكت احسن من البلاسيبو فالانديكيشنز بتاعها از فيري فيري مينيمال يا دوبك محصور في الشويه اللي ممكن يكون فيهم ان ازماتيك كومبوننت اند الراشونال اللي لازم يبقى يعني اكستراكتد كده زي الباد تيث ان الناس تدي ستيرويدز وخلاص عشان العيان جاي لنا شكرا
Well, I'm going to be a rather diplomatic. Let's say that the issue is still debatable. This is number one. For Professor Madri, I think you are concentrating that he didn't get benefit, he didn't get a rise in pulmonary function. And most of the studies were, not seeing what's going to happen in the rate of decline of functions and mortality. This is an issue. Another issue, if we, the LABA works. There is no doubt the LABA works. Okay? What about the synergistic effect between steroids and LABA? I would say I can get the benefit of this. Let's come to the side effects. There is a hell of studies now about the uses of steroids in many other diseases like cystic fibrosis, inhaled steroids and cystic fibrosis and bronchitis. And it's proven and it's in guidelines to use inhaled steroids in such very serious infectious diseases. And with no proven increased decolonization or exacerbations. So it's some kind of clue in this debatable situation, you know. That's my opinion.
Thank you very much for this debate. We proceed with the second debate.
Can I comment?
Yes, of course.
Yes, okay. I think I have to agree again because these are all very valid points. And please don't go home trying to say that Professor Khattab said use steroid, Majidi said don't use it. We both use inhaled steroids in COPD, but I think the points are well taken that we need to be sometimes scientific and not follow that. I'm sure that not everybody should be on inhaled steroid. I like, for example, if you look at the new drug, basically roflumilast, and basically roflumilast, it is basically phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor, which is going to be the newer anti-inflammatory drug in COPD. But I like this. They said it works only in chronic bronchitis, not in emphysema. It was very clear from the beginning. This anti-inflammatory pathway works very well in chronic bronchitis. It decreases exacerbation, improves basically the quality of life. It did not work at all in emphysema. Maybe we should do the same in basically steroid. Maybe because we are lumping everybody, we get this noise from the literature that we get the emphysema with steroid, maybe does not work well. Maybe chronic bronchitis it works, but unless we really separate, like they did in the roflumilast, basically data, which now showed clearly that you should use roflumilast very early in chronic bronchitis. And that's been FDA approved now. But they say clearly don't use it in emphysema. So maybe we should do the same with inhaled steroid. Because I think lumping everybody and say it works or it does not work, it is really a problem.
هشام اتفضل لك هشام كلام
We were putting the COPD in one bag, yes. Which is wrong. But right. I think ICS has some indications on some places. If the question was, do you have a place with the COPD? I have to.
Okay, so we'll proceed to the second debate. Majid Idris, you're going to give the start with Lala.
For Tariq. I want just to add one point from the statistical, in the two offers were very lucid and to the point, to the extent, and the not sure sector has dwindled down to zero, which means that they impressed the audience by their information, whether pro or con. Thank you both.
السؤال برضو usually introduce ICS in COPD management. Early, late, ولا not sure. لا ده احنا قلنا دي لا. التانية بقى اللي هي اللابا اللابا لا السؤال اللي بعده. early, late. حطيت سؤال تاني يا تامر شو ده؟ انا عايز فنجان قهوه لو سمحت فنجان قهوه تمام. طب نرجعها نشوف الفوتنج كان ايه تاني. معلش نرجع السلايد اللي قبله. لا عشان اعيد الفوتنج كمان. يوجد انتروديوس اي سي اس ان سي او بي دي مانجمنت ايرلي 17%، ليت 78%، نوت شور اباوت 6%. اوكي طب نحط بقى السؤال اللي بعده علابه ولامه. In treatment of COPD, usually you start with a LABA, LAMA, or not sure. Okay. 69% لابا ولاما 31%، نوت شور 0%. اوكي والسؤال اللي بعده هو سؤال واحد. لا اتفضل في المكان.
So okay, so we'll start now الفقرة الثانية. And now we're going to talk about LABA versus LAMA. And it seems that most people voted for LABA. So maybe I should stop here because I already have 68%. They were saying LABA.
57%.
Okay. So right. So looking at the guidelines now, guidelines said long-acting beta-2 agonist or long-acting anticholinergic, basically long-acting bronchodilator, should be the drug that should be used in early COPD, starting from the moderate stage of COPD. And that's kind of agreement. And people did not bother at that stage to go to say which one is really superior to each other. And if you look at my side, looking at the LABA, the long-acting beta-2 agonist, and its role in COPD, I'll start to say that the drug is very effective. There's no doubt about it. And looking at formiterol against placebo, and was no doubt that using long-acting beta-2 agonist formiterol is superior by improving lung function significantly, and more important than lung function is improving the quality of life at the respiratory questionnaire at St. George get basically less, and here reflected by less use of Ventolin as well. Again, reflection for the quality of life, basically improvement. So the data is very clear. It's, I'll say, level A evidence that LABA worked very good in COPD. Now, the question here in this debate is to say it is anticholinergic or beta-2 agonist. Which one to start to really basically start with? If you look at recent study in the New England Journal of Medicine, it compared basically tiotropium versus solmitrol, and they looked at the exacerbation rate, and they found that tiotropium was superior than solmitrol in reducing exacerbation by 17%, and that was statistically significant. So this was a good study looking at the exacerbation aspect from that anticholinergic are better than beta-2 agonists in this. However, if you look at the other molecules, basically in the two classes, for example, comparing formiterol versus ipratropium bromide, again, the beta-2 agonist and anticholinergic, it was the opposite, that it was basically beta-2 agonist long-acting formiterol was much better than the short-acting anticholinergic drug from the lung function improvement. And the quality of life, as you can see, improved significantly with LABA formiterol compared to anticholinergic ipratropium bromide. However, it will be easier even for Professor Khattab to come and tell me, come on, because ipratropium is not tiotropium. And you cannot extrapolate data that formiterol is better than ipratropium, this means that formiterol is better than tiotropium. And I have to admit, I'll say this is basically true, but it's equally true that not all beta-2 agonists are the same. And solmeterol and formeterol and Ventolin, salbutamol, are totally different molecules. So if one study showed that tiotropium is better than solmeterol, that should not be taken as it's better than all long-acting beta-2 agonists. For example, in this paper, comparing formeterol versus solmeterol and looking at the improvement in the lung function, there was clearly that formeterol is superior in those basically group of patients. So what I'm trying to say here, it's very difficult to use that as class drug of a certain class. You have to look at the data towards the drug itself. So it seemed that we do have evidence that ipratropium is the least effective. The beta-2 agonist versus tiotropium, in my mind, is not very clear. This study comparing formeterol versus tiotropium, but it was only short-term trial, and in few hours, formeterol was superior in improving lung function. Tiotropium only catched up after about 4 to 5 hours. So again, that's another signal that some kind of beta-2 agonist could be superior than another, and it could be even superior to long-acting anticholinergic drug. Having said that, I think the debate did not stop here. And to me, I have difficulties to you and to myself to be very sure that one drug is better than really another. But what I can tell you that there is data to show that these two drugs are not, in my opinion, competitors. And data show that if you combine the two drugs, probably you get the best effect. Like basically in the CLIMB study, when people failed on tiotropium, they were randomized into tiotropium versus Symbicort, formeterol abidocinide versus a placebo, and they followed them for 12 weeks. And they found that the combination of tiotropium Symbicort was superior than tiotropium alone when it comes to lung function and when it comes as well, when it comes as well to the quality of life. So the quality of life improved significantly with the combination of the two drugs rather than having one drug alone. So what I'm trying to tell you here is the following, and again that's probably going to go with our previous debates. What are we talking about? If we talk about which one is better, my feeling, and because I'm taking the side of LABA, I'll tell you there is no conclusive evidence that any one of these two drugs are superior. However, there is evidence that LABA, especially formeterol, work faster, and comparing it to the old short-acting ipratropium, LABA was superior. That's all what I can tell you. I have no problem to say that ipratropium worked as good, but I need to see the data for that. So my take-home message to you is the following. Long-acting bronchodilator, in my opinion, are very reasonable first-line treatment in COPD, starting from stage 2 up to stage 4. You can add other drugs later on. There is no enough data to favor one class of drug to another. There is data to favor one drug over another, tiotropium versus solmeterol, but not versus formeterol, and vice versa. Formeterol and solmeterol, like tiotropium and ipratropium, are very different, and they should not be considered as one class of medication. Data has shown that it was the combination of long-acting anticholinergic and long-acting beta-2 agonist is probably doing the best for our patient. Thank you very much for your attention.
عادل ستارت ويز لاما.
جاي هو الظاهر ان انا واخد الاصعب الليله دي بس مش مشكله بس before I start I have the same comment and conclusion like you Majdi هما ال two drugs are not competitors وبالعكس they are complementary في كل ال guidelines انه even اخر حاجه اللي هي كانت الشهر اللي فات في شنغهاي انه sometimes some of the physicians start with LABA, others start with LAMA, but if the patients here are not controlled by LAMA alone, or they're not controlled by LABA alone, you get best result with the combination. I have another comment, إنه الناس اللي ما تحسنوش على التايتروبيوم, you did not compare it with formoterol. You compare it with combination of formoterol and budesonide. وكأنه again انت بتقول ان البيوداسينويد here هذا رول لانك انت مع في الستادي دي ما عملوش comparison ما بين الفورميترول والتايتروبيوم فورميترول لوحده ده حطوا combination of formoterol مع البيوداسينويد الرأي اللي بيقول ليه نستارت بلاما ده بيتكلم الاول من ناحية الفسيولوجي ده النورمال كولينيرجيك تون بتاع الايرويز ولما بيبقى exposed للسموكينج بيحصل increase في الريزيستنس لكن مع استعمال الانتي كولينرجيك الايفكت ده بيروح سو كولينرجيك تون از ذا اونلي ريفرسبل ميكانيزم ان سي او بي دي ان كونتراست تو اسما انا مش عايز اقول لكن الدكتور طارق سمع اول امبارح وانا سمعت انه الشركه اللي بتعمل برودكشن للتايتروبيوم بتقول انها في 2013 هتتكلم على الاستخدام بالتايتروبيوم في علاج الاسما لسه ما اعرفش ازاي بس احنا سمعنا الدكتور طارق وانا سمعنا الكلام ده anyway الكولينرجيك اكشن ان ذا لانجز كلنا عارفين انه الام 1 على الباراسيمباثيك جانجليون فاسيليتيت ريليس اوف استايل كولين وفي البوست جانجليونيك سينابس انهبيت ريليس اوف استايل كولين والام 3 في الاير واي سموث ماسل والميوكاس جلاند ده الام 3 الانتيكولينرجيك اكشن بيشتغل على الثلاثة. Let me start with the uplift study ودي كانت landmark study اتعملت على about 3000 patients in 490 clinical clinician participants في 37 countries وده كان long term trial 4 years assessment effect of tiotropium على ال clinical course of COPD. Cannot be compared to tiotropium with the usual care, all other respiratory medication other than inhaled anticholinergic. In a type, the decline in lung function, a rate of decline in post bronchoscopy, في significantly decreased the rate of decline استخدام التايتروبيوم versus البلاسيبو. An improvement in quality of life when early intervention with tiotropium highly significant tiotropium compared with placebo. Tiotropium reduces the risk of exacerbation by the first exacerbation delayed by 5.6 months and 18% reduction of the risk of exacerbation. Also, severe exacerbation leading hospitalization decreased by 26%. The guidelines اللي كانت موجودة لغاية الجولد 2010 كانت سايبة الناس في دايليما ان هي بتقول نستعمل الانهيل برونكو دايليتور بيتر لونج اكتنج وثابت الموضوع مفتوح عشان زي ما قلنا برضو وقالت في الاخر بعد كده ان combination better than one برونكو دايليتور السب اناليسيس بتاع الابليفت استعمال الفيرست لاين في البيشنت اللي هم نايف الكونكلوجن بتاع السب اناليسيس في المينتنس اوف نايف بيشنت تايتروبيوم ريديوسز ديكلاين لانج فانكشن الهيلث ريليتد كواليتي اوف لايف Improved lung function reduces the risk of subsequent additional respiratory therapy and reduces the risk of exacerbation hospitalization over 4 years. القصة المعروفة ودايما نعرض الكلام ده انه المشكله في السي او بي دي المشكله الكبيره هي الاكسيربيشن والريكارنت اكسيربيشن دي اللي بتزود البريسلسنس وبتعمل ريدكشن في الكواليتي اوف لايف الانكتيفيتي والدي كونديشننج وتقلل الاكسرسايز كاباسيتي. يبقى وان اوف ماي ايمز في التريتمنت اوف سي او بي دي ان انا اعمل ان الاكسيربيشن دي تقل as much as I can. لما نتكلم على الاكسيربيشن لوحدها في الفيترنز افير اكسيربيشن ترايل تايتروبيوم فيرسس بلاسيبو في significant reduction في الاكسيربيشن وبرضه significant reduction في السيفير اكسيربيشن leading to hospitalization. لما ناخد الاكسيربيشن بس في الابليفت ستادي في highly significant decrease of exacerbation tiotropium versus placebo ونفس الكلام في الاكسيربيشن leading to hospitalization. البويت ستادي اللي ابتدى بيها مجدي كانت اول ستادي بتكمبير الانتيكولينرجيك مع اللابا والتركيز كان على الاكسيربيشن والاكسيربيشن نيد هوسبيتاليزيشن. انا لما سالت ليه خدوا التايتروبيوم فيرسس سالميترول مش فيرسس فولميترول انت عارف ان كل السنترز اللي اتعمل فيها الاستادي مفيش فولميترول اللون فهم عشان كده سالميترول فيرسس تايتروبيوم. دي النتائج زي ما انت عرضتها 17% ريسك difference في ال first exacerbation ال severe exacerbation قل ب 28% وال reduction في risk of premature discontinuation with tiotropium 12% وعملوا analysis لكل الجروب اللي في البويت ستادي ال age اللي اكتر من 65 واقل ال sex ال gold stage ال smoking status البادي ماس اندكس هل كانوا بيستعملوا اي سي اس ولا لا في كل السب جروب كان فيفرنج ذا يوز اوف تايتروبيوم كومبيرد والسالميترول وكان الكونكلوجن بتاعهم ان التايتروبيوم واز سيجنيفيكانتلي مور افكتيف ذان سالميترول ان اول اسيست اكسيربيشن اند بوينت اند اكروس اول ميجر بيشنت سب جروب. الادفيرس ايفنتس سين ان بوينت سي او بي دي ترايل were consistent with the well-established long-term safety profile of tiotropium. Prevention of exacerbation is critical treatment goal in the care of COPD patient, لأنه ده له significant impact على the patient's life and their determinant effect on the course of disease. Choosing the best maintenance therapy for patients from the start can lead to better outcome. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
شكرا يا فراجل ونشوف الفوتينج رأي الجمهور ايه بعد النايس ديبيت دي على اللاما واللابا. افكركم اللابا كانت بيفور الديبيت 69% اللاما كانت 31% فنشوف دلوقتي طيب اللابا قالت عادل مبروك يا عادل بقى في توازن دلوقتي في المرحلة الثانية فاللاما كسبت اللابا ف 53% هارد لك يا مجدي و 47% ف thank you very much for the debate. لو حد عايز يسأل بس هنعمل one or two at most short questions عشان the sake of time و short very short answers. احنا متأخرين ساعة على فكرة متأخرين ساعة مش هيبقى فيه 10 ظهر. الراجل الألماني بتاع الشاف ألماني على فكرة والشاف الألماني ده الميعاد بتاعه عشان يغرب العشاء لازم يبقى مواعيد ثابتة فاحنا مش عايزين نتأخر عن 9. ترى سميح اتفضلي.
message from after these scenarios to the junior doctors.
ويمكن الدكتورة سميحة اللي انا قلت عليه اللي اتحط الكونسنسس بتاع الاشيا باسيفيك الشهر اللي فات ان هم انتقدوا الجولد من ناحية الاف اي دي 1 ومن ناحية الستيجنج وقالوا مفيش حاجة اسمها ستيجنج سيفيريتي هي جريد وخلوا يمكن المسألة أكبر من كده وخلوا ما هواش دراج واحد قالوا ان لازم يبقى فيه بيتر كومباينيشن وقالوا ان الكومباينيشن of the LABA مع اللاما احسن ولو العيان ما استريحش زي ما في الترايل اللي وراها دكتور مجدي انه لابا اي سي اس مع لاما وهنا كان اول مره يتحط في جايد لاينز الفوسفودايستريز انهبيتور.
يا هشام دكتور هشام لا يوسف اتفضل يا هشام.
I thank both speakers right now. We are using both the labs with LAMA COPD. طبعا ما فيش مشكلة يمكن. في بس ليا one question about the use of LAMA without steroid. احب اقولها ان في الجولد اسامبلي ميتنج في امستردام انا حضرته قايلين ان الجايد لاين يجي لا زي ما الدكتور عادل اللونج اكتنج برونكو دايليتورز لابا اور لاما الفابيتيكال.
شكرا يا شيخ. انا بشكر
اتفضل يا مجدي. يا كومنت ريجاردينج ذا سيفتي اوف لونج اكتنج بيتو اجنس ان سي او بي دي اون ذا لونج ران ويذر ان ذا فيوتشر ذير ويل بي سم concern that we are facing in bronchial asthma of using LABA as a monotherapy. I don't think that there is any evidence so far, that long-term use of LABA without anti-inflammatory drug in COPD is detrimental in any way. Maybe because, going back to the previous debate, that the current anti-inflammatory treatment in COPD is not superior. So by adding inhaled steroid, are you improving the safety of LABA? That's probably not shown up. Actually, it was shown in the TORCH study that the pneumonia increased a little bit once you add the combination compared LABA alone. So the point is well taken, but there's no evidence for that at the moment.
أنا بشكر لعيش عشان sake of time بقى. يما مش حيبقى في عشاء خالص. Thank you very much لمجدي وعادل wonderful debate دي. Thank you very much. We proceed to the next symposium, the MSD symposium. May I invite Adel Khattab and Abdel Menem Rabia to co-chair this session. We have two very elegant speakers, Dr. Maisa Sharafuddin. I will talk about allergic airway disease. And after Dr. Hisham Tarraf, the inflammatory nature of allergic rhinitis. I have just a request, please, to make each talk a little bit. وندي فرصة لسم ديسكشن يعني هي المفروض كل توك هاف ان اور لو قدرنا نقللها شوية يبقى كتر خيرنا ممكن يا شيخ خليها 25 دقيقة بس أذنك يا ميسة أرجوك عشان هيبقى في سؤالين بس